quickly as the movie doctor disappeared. And the world entered into a time of absolute darkness. Bad movies streamed without abandon. People were forced to watch their loved ones transformed into miserable piles of Wookiee poo. And no protection from the utter cheese that those movies created could be found. The world once again cried out for a hero. A hero with the strength and power to watch these terrible films. Someone with the balls to stand up to Hollywood's greediest of bottom lines and save us all from another disaster like Lost in Space. Or even worse, The Room. But finding him was no easy task. It took the combined efforts of Mrs. Bookslaughter, Jake and Trev, Tom, the Rhinus, and even Magic Text to locate and return him back from the brink of that ghastly precipice. The hero came back, a broken man. Cagetober scarred the great bastion of medical movie knowledge, but now, after all this time, he has returned to be the hero. Maybe not the hero this world needs, but the hero this world deserves. But he's not a hero. He's a silent guardian, a watchful protector, a movie doctor.
What year is it?
Hello, movie interns. I am the movie doctor, and welcome back to a new set of Grand Rounds. For today's case study, I thought I'd go a little bit more mainstream and tackle one of those budget-gobbling, steaming piles of My Little Pony vomit, Speed Racer. But before we get into the movie, let's look under the hood at this expensive monstrosity and make sure it doesn't need an oil change. Speed Racer, the manga, was created by the anime pioneer Tatsuo Yoshida in 1958 as Mach Go Go Go. It gained popularity in the 1960s after being adapted into a Japanese anime which ran for 52 episodes. Since then, it spread across the world, and the combination of high-octane racing, gripping story, and interesting technology has been entrancing audiences for over 40 years.
Which is about the same amount of time it'll take for Peyton Manning to win another Super Bowl game.
Nothing?
That's what I get for asking Jake and Trev to write pop culture jokes for me.
In 1992, developments for a Speed Racer movie began to, well, develop. And wouldn't you know it, the first round of actors to fill the roles included Henry Rollins as Racer X, and Johnny Depp as Speed.
Welcome to the Caribbean, lad.
Sadly, this matchup would never be.
But why is the rum gone?
A series of writers were then hired to churn out scripts for the movie, including Mark Levin, not that one, and the franchise-ruining J.J. Abrams.
I'm in the franchise saving and rebooting J.J. Abrams, not the ruining.
But still, no movie was greenlighted. Even more screenwriters were given opportunities to make scripts. One pair, Warner Brothers, went so far as to give them over $1 million just to write a script. Still, nothing came to fruition. Then the actors began to play the producing game. In 2004, Vince Vaughn tried to spearhead the project and make the movie more character developed. But since production never started, the movie's hopes faded to black once again.
Until a certain pair of siblings were discovered to write and direct the greatest display of special effects since, well, this was popular.
Yes, the legendary Wachowskis of Matrix and V for Vendetta fame were pulled to create a Speed Racer movie to once again bridge art and culture and make humanity weep out of sheer joy. Now, with the pair as bright as the Wachowskis, everything was set to align perfectly for Speed Racer, being a pure, unbridled masterpiece. So what could go wrong?
Two words. Family movie. Yeah. Let that sink in for a second.
The Wachowskis, known for their graphic portrayals and deep emotional themes, wanted to forgo all the messages and philosophy to do a family film to reach a wider audience.
You know,
I have something for Atlanta and Andy Wachowski here somewhere. I just gotta find it. Let me just... Oh, here it is.
Sell out with me, oh yeah. Sell out with me tonight.
And as you can bet, since I'm reviewing it, they didn't reach that estimated $120 million budget that was originally poured into the film. In fact, it didn't even open at number one in theaters. Most critics panned it, and the Speed Racer sequel scripts were probably burned in cathartic happiness that would rival the bonfires that Disney has been having with their recent failures. But in more recent years, Speed Racer has apparently begun to develop a cult following of fans. Maybe we've got a classic on our hands. Let's turn the key, wave the green flag, and see if this bloated monstrosity is anything but worth the watch. So the movie begins with the back of Speed Racer himself, played by Emil Hirsch, where he seems to be preparing himself to... take a math test? Okay, this is Susan Sarandon, who plays Speed's mom, and... hey! Hold on! I'm trying to... 5 minutes in, and we're already lost in the most convoluted expository maze that's ever graced celluloid. And it keeps going for a good 15 minutes more. Now, granted, the racing parts are really pretty to look at, and it is important to try explaining everything that's going on for the viewers to understand the backstory and be introduced to all these colorful characters, but did we have to use the back-and-forth transitions, the oddly dressed announcers, and the constant jumps? This isn't Cloud Atlas, people! So in the interest of saving time, I'm gonna do a little bit of exposition on my own. Speed Racer is the brother of Rex Racer, a very talented driver who supposedly went crooked about 8 years ago,
sending his family and his brother into a down spiral of controversy until Speed made his own claim to the title of racing great by beating the rest of the competition under the watchful eye of his family, and including Mama, Pop, Spreadle, and Muggy, Sparky, and a very grown-up-looking Wesley Adams.
But Speed still has too much respect for his brother, so he slows down at the last second so Rex's record remains unbeaten, and everybody's happy about that for some strange reason!
Is that all?
No! Yes!
So, now that that's all cleared up, we can continue with what the fuck am I watching now?
What is it with every family movie having to pair a kid with some chimpanzee?
It seems like every movie I subject myself to that has a primate in it always ends up being a complete pile of stink cheese. Thankfully, their scenes are short and muted by Polly Litt's generous portrayal of Spritel.
Is that the same nothing that broke my last couch?
No, that was a totally different nothing.
Hey, superstar.
Hey, Trix.
Have you seen the papers this morning?
So the whole racer clan sits down for breakfast and...
Yeah, but there seems to be a lot of...
Okay, so maybe it's that kind of family movie.
Anyway, sponsors have been calling non-stop to sign Speed on as one of their racers. But no one tries harder than this man. This magnificent piece of smarmy capitalism and greed is Arnold Royalton, played by Roger Allam.
President and chairman of Royalton Industries, and it is my honor to meet you both.
And he contributes a lot to this movie, including...
When I was a child, we used to say, Pankuchen sind Liebchen. Pancakes are love.
Pancakes are love.
Pancakes
are
love.
Pancakes are love.
I'm convinced that this man likes pancakes more than anything in this world. If he wasn't obviously the villain of the film and hell-bent on destroying all that was good and holy about the love between a son and his mother...
Seriously. That's a little creepy.
It's clear that Royalton would do nothing more than spend his fortune on making pancakes and building the largest syrup pool in the world to bask in his diabetes-filled breakfast binge.
Pancakes are love.
Yes, they are, Mr. Royalton. Yes, they are.
So Royalton tries to impress the Racer family with his amazingly cheesy CGI-driven building, fancy clothes, and lavish lifestyle that would even make the Kardashians blush. And he tries to have Speed sign with Royalton Industries. But Speed wants to think about it.
If I could.
Isn't the kind of offer I go around making every day, son? You should take a little time. Think about what you saw and heard here, and we'll get together early next week. Deal?
Deal.
Pancakes are love.
Meanwhile, in our second movie...
Mutton Chops McGee threatens Tokyo Drift with murder!
Normally. This is when the movie gets a bit more confusing.
Like we didn't have enough setup already.
The mob boss-like guy is a fixer, who specializes in fixing races for his own benefit. And he's trying to teach one of his employed racers, Togekon, that
resistance is futile.
But Spy Hunter here doesn't take kindly to giant racing semis rolling down the highway.
Michael, you're going too fast.
Gotcha.
Got him! I got him! Great kid! Don't get cocky!
This, by the way, is the unknown Racer X, played by Matthew Fox. Why is he trying to save Togekon? Reasons. Yeah, even though this is a pretty cool scene with plenty of pew-pew and pow-pow, its importance isn't really explained until later. Suffice it to say, it really doesn't need to be in this movie. It's likely being used as a break in the monotonous talking scenes that these Wachowski movies have been notorious for.
Speaking of which... Yep, Speed is overdue to talk to Royalton again, isn't he?
Pancakes, I love.
You're right, Royalton. I can't stay mad at you, you beautiful, sweet roll of breakfast bliss.
I don't think this kind of deal's for me.
You poor naive chump. I'm going to pretend I didn't hear that load of sickening schmaltz, and I'm going to give you a bit of an education. At the end of it, if you're smart, you'll thank me, and then you'll sign that contract.
Something tells me that pancakes aren't love anymore.
There is the true spirit of the golden age of racing.
Ah, geez, not another session of sweeping head transitions followed by flashback after flashback to explain even more to the audience about stuff I'm sure they'd rather not hear about.
You know, most people came to see a movie about racing. And, racing. Oh, and racing!
Not a lesson from the evil world of race economics by Evilton Industries, sponsored by the History Channel.
Racing is evil, and its evil tendrils reach out through history because of how evil it is. Not even historians of today can recount when evil actually took over the world of racing.
If you look back to the beginning days of racing, you may see a very thin place where evil may have come into racing. But no one's for sure.
Let's face it, not even Hitler is this evil. And we are the History Channel. We know Hitler. Just ask our experts.
Aliens.
You just made the biggest mistake of your life!
Family movie, folks. Family movie. So Speed ends up getting into a bad crash at another physically impossible racetrack, and Inspector Detector, no, really, that's his name, and the masked man Racer X pay the family a visit. Inspector Detector. Explaining that the only way that this can all be fixed is if Speed races with Togekon and the eerily secretive Racer X in a cross-country race. Now, you may be wondering why the enigmatic Racer X and Togekon want Speed in the first place. Well, that's never really made apparent. And in fact, throughout the movie, everyone talks about how good a racer that Speed is. But what we've seen is that he's lucky and mediocre at best. Especially compared to the other experienced drivers. So there must be a reason. What could it be?
Hey buddy, wanna sit on your bed and stare longingly at me for a while? We could-
Speed? Are you alright?
I don't know. When I watch you do some of the things you do, I feel like I'm watching someone paint or make music. I go to the races to watch you make art.
Oh, right, of course. He's an artist.
It's more about the fact that he and his family are on the very straight and narrow. They are the physical embodiment of the true, happy, American dream nuclear family that all those Leave It to Beaver shows try to emulate. Honesty is the best policy, the family first stuff, yada yada yada. It's an extreme that keeps popping up throughout the film. It's showing that good is supposed to be the thing that always wins. Which is fine. This extreme is good for something that pops up in this kind of movie. But that's the only thing that goes for the whole family movie thing.
Have you seen the papers?
So yes, this movie enters yet another act preceded by a race which includes all the biggest stereotypes, weaponry, and cel-shaded Zelda bomb explosions you will ever see. To be fair though, it is one of the best races, and it was cool to see all the old favorite gadgets the Mach 5 used, like in the original series.
Let it be said that this movie is never in question on the faithfulness to the anime. They nailed it. Unlike some other movies I can think of.
Anyway, after the first half of the race...
Yep. First half of the race. Go get a sandwich or something. They're going to be doing this for another 15 minutes.
During this time, Speed thinks he knows who Racer X is. To which the mysterious rider said... Okay, look.
Racer X is Rex Racer. Racer X, Rex Racer, Racer X, Rex, Racer X, Rex, Racer X, Rex, Racer X, Rex, what? Get it?
This guy isn't the cleverest for coming up with hidden identities. He's just lucky that no one on this planet is as smart as he is.
Felt like we've been doing it for a long time. If you say so.
Okay, I'll stop nitpicking. Not like this whole movie hinges on this one little detail or anything.
Alright, let's get back on track here. The Fixers try to knock Speed, Rex, and Togekon out of the race with ninjas.
More like a ninja.
Some more racing happens, and wouldn't you know it, the heroes win the race! Were you worried? I was worried.
But of course, this is where it gets a little confusing again.
With the win, it solidifies Togekon and his father's company to be a major power in the world of trade, which sets them up to make a lot of money with Royalton. It's also implied that Togekon was going to give up his invitation to the Grand Prix to Speed, but pulled out at the last second, which pisses Speed off.
Now, why doesn't Togekon give up his invitation to Speed in the first place, thus ensuring his family and Speed's family to be saving face? Never explained. Well, it is. But I was trying to be nice.
See, Togekon was doing all this for his family, to bring back their honor and money, but in my eyes, and you can judge this as you want, movie interns, I think this is where the Wachowskis were getting spread way too thin with their story and decided to just start wrapping everything up, or burning those loose ends from the audience's mind. Which, of course, makes Togekon and his family look just as crooked and dishonorable as the rest of the racers. And that fits pretty well with the original Racing is Evil theme.
So in the long run, the Wachowskis made that look better than it did on screen. It just takes a little bit more explaining.
Finally, we get to the last race, where Speed is playing for all the marbles. He wins, of course, after about, 10 minutes of countless transitions, spinning cars, and ridiculous token statements from the announcers.
Uh-oh, look out.
Ooh, that kid is wily.
Here comes over-under. Yoo-hoo, anybody home?
Tear him up.
Seriously, did they just get Richard Roundtree to sit in a room with the other racing announcers and just make quips at everything they said? And the final moments are spent going back to Racer X, explaining through more exposition that he is actually Rex, while the Racer family celebrates in the winner's circle.
So that was Speed Racer. What the fuck did I just watch?
Now, don't get me wrong, I have a load of respect for the Wachowskis, but their take on this nostalgic animated giant left me scratching my head. There's so much going on in the story that the narrative was... well, there is no narrative! I'm surprised people didn't walk out after the first 20-minute flashback fest. Surprisingly, the whole of the story was tight and consistent, but the way it was presented to the audience, with the constant transitions and always playing the flashbacks during more action sequences, made the action drag, and made the movie feel a bit too ADD. I looked over at my colleagues while we watched the movie the first time, and this was their reaction throughout.
Yay! Yay! Yay!
Suffice it to say, this was an annoying quality. But besides the storytelling, some good qualities did crop up. The actors were generally good choices for their roles. The action scenes that they did have, while over the top, were a spectacle to watch. And I really appreciated the care that was taken with each shot, instead of lazily shooting with a shaky cam or cheap jump shots. I also loved Roger Allam's portrayal of Royalton, but he suffered from the same fate that everyone else did in the movie, of how important you are to the plot at the given time. I completely forget about certain characters for long stretches because they just didn't matter, or they weren't being developed along with anyone else. Even Speed falls victim to this in the earlier parts of the film. But the biggest gripe that I have, and I'll finish with this, is the thought that this is a family movie. There are moments that the themes of family and doing right do come through, and the cartoonish style of effects and action sequences could be seen as excellent pandering to children, but overall, the general feel of the movie fits more into an obtuse niche of people who are more apt to like this type of film. Namely me, my friends, and anybody else that proudly labels themselves as nerds or geeks. We are the people that this movie was made for. We love old anime, the old throwback costumes and styles, the flashy helmets, and the detailing on the cars. It's all really cool and fancy when someone that respects our culture gives us exactly what we were looking for in a movie. Unfortunately, it wasn't sold to us, and the runtime, coupled with the convoluted story, makes this hard to slog through, ultimately making the movie fail for those it marketed to. For my cringe factor, I feel that the only saving grace this movie had was the effects and theme park ride feel to each race, so it doesn't get one of my worst scores, but it will cross the finish line with a solid 7 out of 10. I used to rate it higher at a 9 out of 10, but after watching it again, I feel the decrease is justified. Spritel wasn't as annoying as I remember watching it before, anyway. And besides,
pancakes I love.
Pancakes I love.
Pancakes I love.
Pancakes
I
love.
Pancakes I love.
Pancakes I love.
Whoa, that escalated quickly. Well, movie interns, until next time, it's good to be back. I am the Movie Doctor, and I'll see you in the exam room. Hey, movie interns, thanks for watching the show. You can check out my other videos on my Movie Doctor website on Blip TV. You can check me out on Facebook, Twitter, and check out our new site with me and a couple other reviewers at peanutbutterdisaster.com. A little weird, but it's a lot of fun, and all of our reviewers are looking forward to seeing you. See you next time.
Pancakes. I love.